Good evening. And welcome to the 14th annual Interfaith service for the beginning of the new year here at the historical Seamen's Bethel. The office of the mayor, who has just joined us, Mayor Mitchell, as well as the Interchurch Council, gathers everyone, but this is truly a city service, and we thank you all for coming. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, as we come before you tonight, as we come to, as brothers and sisters in the Lord, as we come as folks from all different faiths, nationalities, Lord, as we come as the mixture that you have created New Bedford to be, the diversity and all its beauty, Father, we just come before you tonight and ask for your blessing. Ask for you to look upon us and to lead us even into this new year. As the old one passes, as we see that which has gone before us, the good and some bad, some things were actually ugly. But as we go into the new year, there's always hope. There's always expectations. There's always encouragement that we can offer one another as we look to see what you will do and what we can do as we follow you and your writings and your teachings, as we all look to see how we can work together. That's our prayer tonight, and we thank you for it. Amen. Mr. George Bailey will lead us in a hymn. So if those who can would rise.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of her.
Amen. Now I know we are cold and we came in from outside, we're a little chilly, but by the next time we're singing a hymn, we're going to be nice and strong and bold because we'll have warmed up, right? There's a little bit of cheerleader in me, okay? So just a little bit. Every year we attempt to have a few different speakers. And this year we have Reverend Christopher Mork, who will be coming to speak to us first from Grace Episcopal Church. Chris comes to us with a background that is a little bit different than a lot of us. He's been in a foreign country for a few years, and speaking Spanish, and basically is come here to do mission work, I think. That's what I told him when he got here, because there's a lot of work to be done here also. But we welcome Pastor Chris to the pulpit to share some words with us.
I can just stand here.
You could.
On the heat, then.
You could.
So a few weeks ago, I was doing something that I do every year about this time, right? I transfer information from one year's desk calendar to another. It's a little ritual I have. So as the year's ending, I sit down and I look at my desk calendar from the year before or the year that's ending, and I write down different things. You know, I do it on paper. You might have heard of this, right? Paper. And the sheets kind of fit into this thing we call a book, right? You've seen these, right? Books. Yeah. I do have a smartphone. I do. But I actually use paper and pencil and an eraser oftentimes to keep my agenda. So I'll be there. I'll be looking through the year. And I'll be marking things down for the year to come. So there are birthdays, right? Anniversaries. Church dates for the coming year. Very important. A lot of those dates don't change, you know. And then there'll be notes I wrote myself this year that's closing so I can remember them in the year to come. So maybe this hymn didn't work out so well. Of course, that's never true, but different notes, and I just want to remember what happened and take stock in a way of what happened in the closing year for the year to come. So usually, this is a very ordinary task. It's almost mindless. I'm just kind of transferring information, going through the year. But this year was different. This year, it felt different. As I took a look through the soon-to-be-finished calendar year for 2013, it became more than just an empty, ordinary task. I started to actually reflect. I started to reflect on the things that had happened through this year. I paused over different events that had taken place. Gatherings that we had, even appointments. And to be honest, I lingered. I lingered at some of the more difficult moments of this year, some of the challenges that I or the parish faced. I lingered a little, maybe too long, at the loss of loved ones and the loss of some dear parishioners. And as I did that, I also experienced a certain, even timid, sense of the blessings that had happened. The blessings that had happened in the midst of the challenges, even in the midst of the loss. I'm not talking just about the achievements and those things that we can feel proud of. I'm not talking about the high points through this last year. But the blessings, the gifts, the good things that occurred even in the midst of loss, even in the midst of difficulty, even in the midst of the challenges. This is a sense I started to get as I went through this last year's calendar, as I started to transfer that data from one year to the next. And as I did that, I felt something urging me to see with new eyes. I felt something encouraging me to look from a different vantage point. I would say to look with hope. To recognize that good is springing forth, however difficult or even painful something might seem at the time. I started to feel encouraged to enter into each day and each encounter looking for God in the midst of it. Now, you know, there are challenges to be sure. In our community in Greater New Bedford, we probably could go around the room and we'd come up with a long list of challenges that our community faces. And even as I think of these, I am moved by the dedication of so many people within those challenges. What has impressed me this year, I would say, and it's my first full year here in New Bedford, so I'm really just a baby. But what has impressed me this year is the number of people who are willing to give of themselves right here in Greater New Bedford to make a better future for us all, to meet the challenges, to actually meet the challenges that we face and meet them as a community, and to work for transformation. So, although we could make a long list, there's no point in having a litany of the challenges, but I think of maybe a handful of specific ones that we've had this year and that we look forward to or look toward in 2014. So something the Interchurch Council has been working on, and the tragedy of teen suicide in our community. I think of something that's been in the paper quite a lot, the cooperation and change needed in our schools. Something else has been highlighted this year, the uncertainty and the exploitation experienced by those in our immigrant communities and other vulnerable groups like the homeless. And then issues of environmental contamination and the need for renewable, sustainable energy. These and many more are real challenges. They're real issues that we're facing here in Greater New Bedford. And within each issue, there are committed people working together for transformation. Within each issue, we hold together possibilities for change. So as we move forward into this new year, I pray that in the midst of the very real issues, the very real problems that we face, and the conflicts, even in the midst of those, as dedicated people truly work and seek, I would say, to work together to solve those and to move forward, I pray that we also look together with hope, with those eyes of hope, that we look together in those issues and not see them just as challenges, but we're ready to see the good that is springing forth even in their midst. And I would pray that we embody ourselves that change that we wish to see in our community. Self-giving. Reconciliation, if I could be so bold. Peace, wholeness, justice. That we would embody those things. That we would look for the best in each other. That we would seek God and God's goodness within each person, within each situation. Not only looking at it as a problem, as a challenge, but saying, where is God in this? And who are we as a community in this? And how can we work together? How can we, I would say, as a clergy person, as a person of faith, how can we show forth God's own generosity, God's own self-giving, God's welcoming embrace in our own lives, in our community? Because we know that the challenges are real, the needs are real, and we're all affected by them. Each one of us here in different ways, each person in our community is affected by these. We share in them. So as we move into this new year, I pray for renewed energy to be lights in our community, embodying in ourselves and in our relationships, in the way we talk to one another, the way we act, in our discourse, embodying in those things that which we wish to see around us, that growth, that reconciliation and peace that we wish to see in our communities. Again, that we would look at each other, we would look at our community through eyes of hope, and that we would work together, especially when there's conflict, especially when there's difference of opinion, that we would work together for the transformation that we all desire. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Chris. I too have a year-end ritual. And it's going through my desk drawers and finding all the things that I probably, don't need anymore. And I found in there pencils and erasers that I don't think I've used in 2 or 3 years. So since you still use them, I'm bringing them by, okay? In fact, I had to remember what, I had to Google it, what was that thing? And it was a pencil. Yeah, I realized. We also have with us tonight, the director of the YMCA, Daniel Berry. Daniel comes to us from Mattapoisett. He is a lay leader in the Mattapoisett Congregational Church. He's quiet most of the time, but I have heard the passion in his heart and the desire that he has for the community and for the youth. And so we invite Daniel to come up and speak to us, please.
I don't think my staff would say I'm very quiet, but I'll send my message with you now. I stand before you now in this beautiful chapel and in a city that is full of hope. I have had the privilege of working in this community for the past 5 years and have invested deeply in our youth and see the potential in them. I recognize that despair and chaos are ever present, but choose to focus instead on hope and being a part of the solution when it comes to mentoring our youth. A quote by author Mitch Albom describes hope best. Hope, no matter how buried, wants to find the light of day and rises from within us until it does. As long as we have people that want to improve the community we live in, hope will be there. As long as we have parents of youth in our community that mentor their children and put service to others above themselves, then we will have hope in our city. For many, the end of 1 year allows us to press the reset button for the new year ahead. We can learn from all mistakes that we made and put them behind us and start fresh. We can celebrate our successes and build on them in the year ahead as well. We have the freedom to right the wrongs, keep the status quo, give up, or move forward. I can look at the 10 pounds I put on in 2013 as an opportunity to lose weight and inspire others around me to do the same, or I can put on 10 more pounds in 2014. It's my choice, although my wife might have something to say about that. For the past 25 years, I have mentored youth as a professional in YMCAs all over New England. I am now blessed, and along with my wonderful wife, to be mentoring, coaching, and parenting my own 3 children, who are right over there. I would like to share with you 2 short excerpts from 2 coaches' authors that inspired me when working with youth, and knowing there is much hope and promise ahead of us and in the future of our city. The first excerpt is from the great coach John Wooden, who coached UCLA to 10 national championships out of 12 years of coaching there. It says this: my favorite 4-letter words, kids and love. The greatest word in the whole dictionary is love. Love your children, listen to them, share with them. Remember that love is the most powerful medicine in the world. Do not force them or drive them too hard. Set the example of what you want them to be. Try always to be a good model. Children are impatient. They want to do right, but maybe they don't know how. Maybe you haven't taught them how. Being a good example is a powerful teaching device. This verse is accurate. No written word nor spoken plea can teach our youth what they should be, nor all the books on the shelves. It's what the teachers are themselves. And the author of that is unknown. And another one of my favorite authors, and also an NFL football coach, Tony Dungy, from the book Uncommon, says this: God calls us to be faithful, not successful. He calls us to follow those dreams that are in our hearts and pursue them with all our might. Sometimes they will proceed in ways that make them a success in worldly terms, but other times it may feel more like futility. Sometimes we'll be able to witness changed lives, and sometimes the only life we can see changed is our own. God's scorecard is different from ours. He does want to bless us, but his scorecard doesn't use money or material possessions or fame or status. He judges by the state of our hearts and our desire to serve him. And from 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart.'" So, with 2014 just a few short hours away, will you right your wrongs, keep the status quo, give up, or be part of the solution? The choice is yours. Amen.
I truly count it a privilege and an honor to be able to stand before you tonight and to be able to share a word of encouragement, a word of expectation. I wish you a happy new year, and I pray that this coming season and this coming year be a blessed one for you and all the families that are represented here tonight. I want to direct your attention to a classic passage found in the book of Ezekiel, and I'm going to read the first 10 verses in your hearing. And the word of the Lord reads like this: "The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones and caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, 'Son of man, can these bones live?' And I answered, 'O Lord, thou knowest.' And again he said unto me, 'Prophesy unto these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and ye shall live, and ye shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came up upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Then he said unto me, 'Prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet an exceeding great army." I want to say to everybody here that the Lord's commandment for New Bedford is to live. The Lord's commandment for New Bedford is to live. It is not a disposition, it is not just an attitude, it is not a suggestion, and it is not an opinion, but it is a commandment. It is an order from the Lord, and when you are commanded to live, you are commanded to expect. And if you are commanded to expect, you are commanded to receive. And if you are commanded to receive, you are commanded to achieve all the things that God would have for you in his perfect will, plan, and agenda. In this passage, there was a group of bones just lying in a valley, completely dry, and it was symbolic of the nation of Israel and a lack of hope. And what ended up happening was Son of Man, which was Ezekiel, prophesied unto these bones. He spoke to a dead situation. He spoke to a lifeless situation. He spoke to a hopeless situation. And in process of being obedient to God, God caused this ruach to breathe on them. And that ruach is that breath. And when he breathed into them, they came alive together and they stood upon their feet as a great army. I want to say that the Lord's commandment for New Bedford is to live. If you're dealing with any struggle, if you're dealing with any adversity, if you're dealing with any hardship, if you're dealing with any lack of finances, if you're dealing with any sickness, the Lord's commandment is to live. In spite of it all, God wishes the best for you, desires the best for you, and has the best for you. So coming into a new year, with all the adversity that will be in the community and all the things that we face as a community, as a family, knit together, made in the image of God, the commandment is to live. Amen?
Amen.
The commandment is to live. And if we keep that in our minds, that God wants us to live, and it's not just existing, it's not just mere breathing, it's not just mere going from day to day and going from duty to duty and monotony into monotony. It is going from the mediocre to the extraordinary. God is the God of the extraordinary. And so I won't be before you long tonight, but I just want to say that God's commandment is to live. He is a God of the living. And if you call him your God, or if you believe in his existence, and if you trust in his word, then you know that you're serving a God of life. You're serving a God of that is vital to your life, and that is the core, and that is the background, that is the foundation. And so for all the people, the young people that are struggling in the community, for those that are luminaries, those that are working in the community, trying their hardest to do their perfect part, the commandment is to live. And if we can receive the word of life, we can have life. And that is all I have to say tonight. God bless you.
That's the diversity that we have in this community. And that's the excitement that we have. And even though we heard from three different people with three different mannerisms, three different styles, I think we heard the same thing. Working together, we can accomplish much. And there is hope in everything that we have before us. Hope that we're going to have a dance soon. Hallelujah. As he's finishing that, before I bring up someone else, when we are done, after the mayor brings his words to us for the new year, I would like to ask all the ministers that are here, any and every minister that is here that would like to come and offer up your prayers for the new year. Are we doing that one? Okay. Again, this is Endelis Cartagena.
Mary, did you know that you'll be
And Elise, that was wonderful. Thank you. I couldn't have done that. My bathrobe doesn't go up that high. One of the things that the Word of God tells us is that we're supposed to pray for our leaders. And we're going to be bringing up the mayor now to bring some words in a church setting for the city, for the new year. In less than a week, he'll be being inaugurated again for a second term. There's been a lot of challenges. There's a lot of things that are going on, but there's also been a lot of good things that have been happening too. It's according to the Word of God that we as Christians know, but I also know in many other writings, it is our responsibility to pray for those who are in leadership. Tells us that we're supposed to do that so that we'd have peace. Tells us that we're supposed to do that so that they would have wisdom. It's our responsibility to hold up their arms. It's our responsibility to support them. So with those words in mind, I'd like to invite up our mayor of the city of New Bedford, Mayor John Mitchell.
Thank you, David, and good evening, everybody. So last year when I spoke at this gathering, I was at the top of the order, the leadoff batter, and Reverend Lehman moved things around a little bit because he knew that I had to speak earlier, and just in case I was late, moved me down. But the problem was that turns out I've had to follow in the lease. And next year, David, make sure I'm right at the beginning. I don't have to follow in the lease and her beautiful performance next year. And at least a job well done. It's always an honor for me to speak in this pulpit. My grandfather's among the lost fishermen that are listed on this cenotaph right here. So it's always very humbling for me to come into this space. I want to begin with a secular thought because that is my place in this context. I really, more than anything, want to thank the clergy who are here and who are, and others in our community, other clergy in our community, for all the support they give me in my role as mayor, but give our community day in and day out. They are truly the bulwark of the civic life of Greater New Bedford. Chris mentioned earlier one example of, and that's the example of the teen suicides that we've suffered over the last few years, and how clergy in the community have stepped up to be there for families who've suffered and to help other children who are feeling at low points in their lives, or feel as though they've hit low points in their lives. And they've made a difference. They've stepped up. And partnered with government, but partnered more particularly with families to reach out at a moment of need. And so, but it's just one example of many in which the clergy that you will hear from tonight, will have heard from tonight, have made a difference and have made us stronger. And this service really tonight is emblematic of the kind of community we have, that we have this interfaith service in which we have community, have clergy from every denomination in the city come forward to offer their hopes and their prayers for the year ahead. So, David, I thank you in particular for your leadership today and always in our community, and thank all the other clergy for being there for us. New Year's is a time, of course, to take stock, to look backwards over the year before and to look forward with hope for the time ahead. And it's fitting that we do this. You know, we live as mortals, we live with hope all the time. We have to live with hope, but we live with hope knowing that our actions matter in this world, and sometimes in ways that don't always make sense to us in the moment. But you know, as we reflect on the choices we make and how they matter to others, we need to sometimes remind ourselves of the broader context. And so I wanted to read a poem by a poet that hits this point home, and her name was Hannah Flagg Gould, who reminds us about our choices in this world and their place beyond. And it goes like this. Alone I walked the ocean strand. A pearly shell was in my hand. I stooped and wrote upon the sand, my name, the year, the day. As onward from the spot I passed, one lingering look behind I cast. A wave came rolling high and fast and washed my lines away. And so, methought, 'twill shortly be with every mark on earth from me, a wave of dark oblivion sea will sweep across the place where I have trod the sandy shore of time and been to be no more. Of me, my day, the name I bore, to leave nor track nor trace. And yet, with him who counts the sands and holds the waters in his hands, I know a lasting record stands. Inscribed against my name, of all this mortal part has wrought, of all this thinking soul has thought, and from these fleeting moments caught, for glory or for shame. I wish you a blessed 2014. And may I wish you the confidence in knowing that our efforts to put our interest above ourselves, to sacrifice for others, to make our community a better place, matters in ways that we can't even understand. Happy New Year, everybody.
If I have the clergy, please come and line up over here, because with the mic here this way, they'll be able to hear on cable. Reverend Mark, will you be able to come up here, or shall I hand you the mic?
I think I get it there.
Any clergy that are in the house, Pastor Steve, don't make me call you out. So that'll be recorded.
Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we approach your throne of grace tonight. We pray that as we usher into a new year, that you would usher us into blessing, that you would usher us into great provision, that you would usher us into mercy and kindness, that you would usher us into a new way of life, a new way of thinking, a new disposition, and a new attitude, and that you would usher the city of New Bedford into a new experience, an experience of a God from above that commands them to live. Heavenly Father, we ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. I do pray that God would bless us and keep us, that we would be able to act, as John said, not out of fear or bitterness or aggression, but work together and act out of love. That God would continue to fill us with God's own love and life in this new year. Amen.
Father, it's with great anticipation that we commence this new year. We thank you, O God, that Isaiah had a glimpse of what you would mean to the world, and he said your name would be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Lord, we walk through the portal of 2013 and say goodbye, and Lord, we embrace with great anticipation, with great faith and hope, that as we commence 2014, we will walk hand in hand with you, and that you will go with us wherever we go. We ask your blessing on this city, upon every official, from the mayor's office to the police, to our health system, Lord, for the constituents, for our children. We pray that the Prince of Peace would be made manifest and real in each life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's an old Jewish custom of Jews gathering in the synagogue on the last day of the Hebrew month. And they would fast for half a day and would come in the evening to the synagogue for prayers. And the prayers were about the conclusion of the old month with its problems, with its difficulties, and the optimistic look to the next month. Let the next month be better. We can work together. We can resolve our problems. We are optimistic and look to the future. We can try to resolve problems. As the moon, we look at the moon is always the same size. But how it rotates around the sun, it looks differently. Quarter, an eighth, half, full moon. So too, we begin the new month. It's just the beginning, just flick of the moon you see. And as the month goes on, you see more and more of the moon till you see the full moon in all its glory. The new year is coming, 2014. And the prayer is now that we should bid farewell to the old year and look the new year to begin, united, working together. The only way we can progress and make 2014 the best year of all the years. God bless New Bedford and the United States of America. Thank you.
You're right. All right, you're right. Okay, I'm working fine. I'm fine. Good evening. As I swiftly move toward my 82nd birthday, which would be March the 18th, I am more than grateful to stand here and offer this prayer. Well, Father, as we anticipate the dawning of a new, glorious, and productive new year, we're more than grateful for the opportunity to start brand new. As we worship here this evening, we are mindful that annually, you're always offering us new dawns, new days, new opportunities to walk with you, no matter what has gone on before. For those opportunities and more, we offer you our thanks for the gift of forgiveness, compassion, and preservation. We are grateful and we shout, hallelujah, glory. As we proceed into the new year, we thank you for your word which says, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassion fail not, they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. We declare this evening that because you are our portion, our strength, our God, our way maker out of no ways, we will wait patiently on you. And as the new year unfolds, offering to us new opportunities to get things right and set things in good order, we do so with all of our hearts, our minds, and souls. Amen.
If we would all rise as we, Mr. George Bailey will lead us, and Miss Beverly Cotton will play for us. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Thank you, George, and thank all the participants here tonight. And thank you for coming out. It's a night of celebration, a night where there's a lot of things going on in the community. And you've chosen to be here with us. You've chosen to be here together, one with another, to first seek blessings for the new year. As a minister of the Lord, as a minister in this community, I count myself blessed for the opportunities to be able to work with people that care and that really want to make a difference. So my prayer for you and for all of us is that in the new year, we will find more ways, better ways of communicating with one another, of strengthening one another, of looking to each other, because if we all have the same idea to do for someone else before I do for myself, you won't have to worry about your needs being met because somebody else will be looking for you. But there's somebody out there that you're able to reach that maybe nobody else can. Someone who may be depressed and thinking of doing harm to themselves or to others. Someone who's hungry and or cold and is going to be in a place that's difficult tonight and tomorrow and next week, next month. There's somebody needs you just like you need somebody. Let us all be there for one another. For our benediction tonight, I invite, wanted to make sure he was there, Pastor Hector Hernandez from the Potter's Church.
God bless you all. What can we say? 2013 has been a great year for many of us. It has been a year of ups and downs. But we have seen that in the midst of the struggles, in the midst of the good times, we could say that the Lord has always manifested himself among us and has never departed as the livers forsaken. And it's an honor to say that as 2014 is new here to come, that as faith community and fellow members of the faith community and pastors and Reverend and the mayor that's here today and many of you that live in the city, to come together to make a difference. I was talking and I spoke this Sunday, which was the last Sunday of this year, and I spoke to my church and I stated how many things get registered during the year. Exactly like Red Sox winning the World Series. I know Dave is happy about that. And many other good things have happened during 2013. But I was stating to the church how everything gets registered, but there's one thing that never gets registered is the storm that we all go through. What was the storm that you went through this year? Only you know it. You're the only one who registered. But there's something that I've learned that after the storm, there's always something that happens, and it's called rehabilitation. And we need to understand that every storm, after it, brings a moment of rehabilitation. Rehabilitation needs two things. One of them is called people to get together in unity to rebuild something. And the other thing is strength, power. And power is something that you give yourself or you motivate yourself to give. And through that motivation, you could achieve and get things done for better. Now, what is the storm that each and every one of us been going through? We know it ourselves. But there's something also important about all of this. The Bible says in the book of Matthew, there's an example of a man that built a house on top of what? Of a rock. And it says that the storm hit it, the waves came in, but the house stood still because it was built on top of the rock. What is that rock? It's Jesus Christ. That's our salvation. That's our insurance. That is our security. And these last words and what I want to say to you guys is, let's enter 2014 remembering about Jesus Christ and what he's done for us. And what better than God that to fulfill and to better this place for us, because he has. In the midst of our problems, in the midst of our circumstances, God is the only one who's been there for us. So I bless each and every one of you, and I ask that 2014, we join together to build a better New Bedford. We join together to achieve better goals for the city. Not only that, make history on a city that made history in the past. We could rebuild dreams that have been broken. We could rebuild homes that have been broken. And the only way we're going to do that is through building something together and everybody joining together to make this happen. I'm going to pray for everybody. I think am I all set here? And I'm going to invite you to bow your head. Dear Father, thank you for this blessed moment. For this moment that you have given us to join together here tonight as we say bye to 2013 and we say welcome 2014. I ask, dear Lord, that you cover us, protect us as we enter into this new year. And I know that there's many great blessings coming this way. I understand, dear Lord, that you are to open, dear God, the floodgates of heaven and pour abundantly upon each and every one of us. Thank you for this moment. Thank you for this time of unity, dear Lord, that we share among each and every one of us. Thank you, dear Lord, for all these great men that you have placed along us, dear Lord. And thank you, dear God, for the government and whoever's working in the city, the mayor, his office, all the employees, everybody that's part of this city to make a better place for each and every resident that lives here. Thank you for everything, God, as I place everything in your hands, dear Lord. Amen.
God bless everybody. Have a happy new year.